Morning Glory America, bonjour, hi, Canada, Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway on Election Day. It's finally here, and I'm hoping late tonight when I'm hosting the Salem News radio channel, Salem News Channel coverage, I call Blake Masters as the winner in Arizona. Blake Masters joins me now. Good morning, Blake. How are you?
Good morning, Hugh. Feeling really good.
Running through the tape?
Absolutely. We're the underdog, but we're going to win. Both those
now,
things are true.
Talk to me about what things are out there on the trail like. I know you've been out with Carrie Lake. She's running by probably 10 points. I think you're going to come in about 3 or 4 behind her, but still with a healthy win. Does it feel that way?
It really does. You know, I mean, we just had a rally in Queen Creek, Arizona last night, a giant barn. There were 400 or 500 people there. It was packed. That's the kind of energy that we have. You know, a Mark Kelly or Katie Hobbs rally, I don't know, they might get 31 people, 26 of them are wearing masks. It's just very low energy. We've got the momentum. Again, we're not complacent. We've got to run through the tape. But our grassroots patriots here and just normal people, independents, even some Democrats, they're fired up to actually put the brakes on this Biden administration and take back our country.
The worst inflation in the United States is in the Phoenix metro area. That's Maricopa County. And that's where Democrats typically win when they win and lose when they lose. How do you feel about Maricopa County?
Seems like we're on track to either fight Senator Mark Kelly to a draw in Maricopa County, or actually think, no, we can win Maricopa County. And we're going to run up the score of the rural counties, too. So the path to victory is clear. The path to Democrat victory is getting vanishingly smaller by the day.
But we need people to vote. I don't know how you spend Election Day. I don't know what the plans are for the whole day, but I hope it's just get out the vote interview after get out the vote. Because some people are beginning to take a red wave for granted, and there is nothing for granted until it's counted.
You're right. That's the biggest danger. You know, we feel really great right now, but, I mean, make no mistake, the Democrats in Arizona, they have an advantage in the early vote. More Democrats showed up to vote early than Republicans. This didn't surprise us, right? We're expecting a giant wave tomorrow, but people have to be willing to bring food and water because there might be lines, right? It might be hot here in Arizona. So we got to show up.
And you've got to be in line, and then you stay in line, even if the election hour. What? How late do they stay open, Blake?
Polls close at 8, but you know if you're in line by 8 and it takes until 11 p.m. to vote, you got to stay. It's the future of the country on the line. You got to stay in line.
I want to close by talking about what I think is the iceberg issue, which is education, and I do think. A lot of first-time Republican voters are going to be voting for Republicans because of what happened in our schools over the last 2 years. Surely inflation is on people's mind. I know crime in the border in Arizona matter, but what about parents and education, Blake Masters?
We've got a parents' rights movement in the country, and I think we're the tip of the spear here in Arizona. Parents, turns out they didn't like when their kids' schools were locked down for no reason. And then when they finally opened the schools, right, when the teachers' unions finally just had to relent, okay, your kid's back in school, year and a half behind, oh, now they have to wear a mask. Now they have to sit in a plexiglass box, right? It makes no sense. And then what are they being taught in school? Not reading, writing, and arithmetic, not shop or home economics, no. Critical race theory, gender ideology, I mean, this is just absurd. So I think parents... you know, maybe the one silver lining, if you can call it that, of the crazy pandemic, parents finally saw what was going on in their kids' classrooms. They didn't like it. They're leading a bottom-up mama bear, papa bear revolution. And they know that only Republicans are going to fix this mess that the Democrats have caused.
In many districts across the country, schools are closed today because teachers' unions have long negotiated for Election Day closure because they like to work the polls for Democrats. This is a mistake this year. If the school is closed, in your, it's just going to remind people of all the years that they've been closed.
I think that's right. I think that's right. And to the extent we have a red wave tomorrow, and I think it's going to be a big one and glorious, I think it's the pissed off parents that are going to be leading the charge.
I agree. Blake Masters, good luck through the end and kicking through the ticket. I know you will. And good luck to Carrie Lake as well. I'll be up late. Maybe I'll talk to you as we get closer to the midnight hour. When do you expect to know, by the way, Arizona time?
You know, I think the networks might declare it for Carrie Lake tonight because she's going to win by so much, again, or tomorrow night. Mine might take till Wednesday morning. It really might. We have those late early ballots that don't get counted until Wednesday. But we'll have a good sense when you and I chat late tomorrow night.
All right, Blake Masters, thank you, my friend. Have a great Election Day.
Thank you, Hugh. Talk to you soon.
The final polls that came out, and by the way, Arizona may have a little bit of weather today. Nevada is definitely going to have some snow in Reno and maybe down to Vegas. I don't think so. But Reno, get out and vote. I don't care if you have to put the snowshoes on. Get out and vote because the rural counties in the Silver State have to offset the union vote in being driven by limo to and basically John Ralston's driving Democrats to the polls this morning. But I do want you to get out and vote, even in California, even if you're a Democrat. Get out and vote. It's going to be raining like mad throughout California. Has it begun to rain out there yet, Generalissimo? I want to do a quick rundown of polling. I just want to
start it. Not yet, but it's supposed to start around 4:30 this morning.
Okay, so it's going to be raining a lot out there. Here are the latest numbers. Georgia, Walker plus 2. This is from Fox Insider. Georgia, Brian Kemp plus 5. Georgia again, WANF-TV Landmark, Walker plus 1. Georgia again, WANF, Kemp plus 6. Georgia again, Trafalgar, Walker plus 3. Trafalgar, Kemp plus 9. There's one tie in there in East Carolina University, but they also say Brian Kemp's going to win by 7. Data for Progress, the Democratic operation, says that Walker is going to win by 1. And Kemp is going to win by 9. Masters predicted by Trafalgar to win by 1. Lake by 4. Masters up 1 in Arizona, according to Data for Progress. That's a Democrat outfit. Lake plus 4. So, boy, they must be feeling terrible. Wisconsin, Johnson plus 6, according to Data for Progress. Michaels in Wisconsin, the governor, the Republican, up 2. Laxalt plus 5, according to Trafalgar Group. Lombardo plus 3, according to Trafalgar Group. Democrats for Progress. Get it. It's a Democrat operation. Laxalt plus 2 and Lombardo plus 2. All the numbers that are coming in late from the Lake States. Last poll to drop last night. All red. Red tsunami. And I actually think it's going to be bigger than I expected it. You know, my over-under has been 25 in the House. And now an over. Now solidly an over. Because you have to wait until Election Day. Stuff always happens, right? Putin dropping some kind of surprise on the international order or anything like that. But nothing happened yesterday. Huge rally. President Trump had a rally for J.D. Vance and Mike DeWine in Ohio. Huge rally. Meanwhile, Dr. Oz skipping across the state with Susan Collins and with Nikki Haley. This is, you know, clearly the best closing team you could possibly have for the swing voters in the suburbs of Philadelphia. And I think Philadelphia is a sick of crime. I just think they've had it. But just in case there's a Pennsylvania voter on the edge. Let's remember what President Biden said in Oceanside, California, Friday, cut number one.
From wind and solar than it is from coal and oil. Literally cheaper. Not a joke. I was just, and so we can accommodate that transition. I was in Massachusetts about a month ago on the site of the largest old coal plant in America. Guess what? Cost them too much money. They can't count. No one's building new coal plants because they can't rely on it, even if they have all the coal guaranteed for the rest of the existence of the plant. So it's going to become a wind generation. And all they're doing is going to save them a hell of a lot of money and using the same transmission line they transmitted the coal-fired electric on. We're going to be shutting these plants down all across America. And having
we'll be shutting
solar
plants down all across America. Grandpa came out and shouldn't have. Then he went on to New York on Sunday. Cut number two, the president.
No more drilling. There is no more drilling. I haven't formed any new drilling. No, that was before I was president. We're trying to work on
that. Yeah, it was all Obama's fault. Joe Biden, Bowie State yesterday, cut number three.
We're going to codify Roe v. Wade in January and make it a rule of the land.
I think that means make it the rule of the land. But the president's getting very tired. Then I got to love this one. Cut number four, we've heard this before. By the way, I want to give you a warning. This is not true. Cut number four.
Great to be in Bowie State. One of our nation's great HBCUs. I was at my home HBCU, Delaware State, talking to students about our plan to relieve student debt. And by the way, you got to forgive me, but I got my start at Delaware State.
You know, that's simply not true. He says it all the time. Glenn, over at the Washington. Play cut five, please. Glenn Kessler gave him an endless pit of Pinocchio's yesterday. Cut number five. The president really putting it on.
Dollars I put in the budget for HBCU. You know why? HBCUs don't have the endowments others have, but guess what? You're just as smart, you're just as bright, you're just as good as any college in America.
That's a little condescending to talk to an all-black, historically black college or university, but the president is mixing condescension with incoherence and infirmity for quite the toxic mix on the political trail. I'll be right back. America's Election Day. Make a plan to vote, carry it out, do it early. The sun is coming up on Election Day, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway. Salem News Channel coverage coming at you from 7 p.m. till midnight, and I will be a part of that. Please join in. Download your Salem News Channel app or just listen to this radio station. Most of them will be carrying the live election night broadcasting as we try and cover the country with live reports from around our various studios across the country and election results as they come in. We are partnered with Decision HQ, which is very, very good at this, in order to bring you the latest breaking news. Let me do a market report brought to you by Birch Gold. Markets, according to the Wall Street Journal, are hoping for a Republican win. Futures are up across the board last night. But gold is down to $1,673 an ounce this morning. The 10-year Treasury went up to 4.214. That's the number, 4.214. That's the Joe Biden economy. It was under 2 when Donald Trump left office. It's over 4. That means your interest rates have gone up about 4 points. On the home purchase that you postponed from last year until this year unwisely. Yesterday, the Dow was up 1%, 423 points. The NASDAQ was up 0.85%, 89. And today, overseas, everything is red, but everything is in a holding pattern. If you get a Republican Congress today, markets are going to begin to rebound because they know that the insanity of spending will be over. Not sure what else is going to, the Fed's going to keep raising rates, but the insanity of raising of spending more money is going to be gone. But your currency is already devalued. You need to buy some gold. Do it from HughGold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. Birch Gold is a specialist. It's setting up 401k, IRA, SEP IRAs, or rolling over abandoned ones that you can begin to add to. They maintain the physical depository into which your silver or gold is deposited. Do not buy collectors. Don't do any of that crazy stuff. Just buy American Eagles. Buy Canadian Maple Leafs or Krugerrands from South Africa. Just buy ounces, and if you're doing it for personal consumption, put them in a safety deposit box and forget about them. Want to play for you Ron DeSantis last night on Fox with Tucker Carlson, cut number 8.
Absolutely, and including on immigration. My first year, we banned sanctuary cities, and news media thought that that would be not approved down here, and yet Hispanic voters in Florida had the highest approval rating for our policy to ban sanctuary cities. We did the transport to Martha's Vineyard, and people thought that this was going to be so bad, and yet Hispanic voters backed me on doing that because they understand the border is out of control. So I think it's on all of these issues, but clearly the Republican establishment view that you need open borders and amnesty to appeal to Hispanic voters in the United States is dead wrong. It was wrong then, and it's clearly been proven to be wrong now.
What I like about that is not only the message, but the fact that DeSantis has almost no voice left. That means it's all on the field. When you run through the tape, it's all on the field. You should not be able to talk. David Axelrod, not looking too happy on CNN with Aaron Burnett last night, cut number 6.
Well, I heard my friend Scott Jennings address this a little bit earlier, and I agree with him. It's not unusual. I mean, back in 2010, Barack Obama wasn't getting as many invitations as he was getting. This year, when he was the incumbent president and people were unhappy with the state of the economy. So that's the nature of politics. I mean, Bill Clinton was the guy people were calling you know, to come then. So it's not unusual, but it is a measure of the fact that Joe Biden is not popular right now, and that has been a millstone for a lot of Democrats.
Not popular, a good understatement by David Axelrod, but he always tells the truth. Steve Kornacki, cut number 7 on MSNBC last night.
The feelings, the environment, the attitude when it comes to the economy, our poll finding that more than 8 in 10 voters say they are dissatisfied with the current state of the economy. We haven't seen a number that high on this question since 2009-10, around the time of the crash, the Great Recession, that period of time. And then when you ask people straight up, what's the most important issue as you make up your mind? Economy and cost of living, inflation, those two combined for 37% here in terms of being the top issue, and the folks who cite that at their top, as their top issue, are breaking in our poll for Republicans by a 43-point margin. So those are the headwinds that Democrats have against them here. Sort of historically speaking,
stop that.
In terms
that's
of
violent.
The climate we're in
that's
right
just
now.
Doing violence to Democrats. 43% ahead. Democrats are losing by 43% among voters who think the economy is the most important thing. Wow. Ouch. Going to be a fun night. if you get out and vote in Nevada, get out and vote. I know it's late. Get in line now. The snow is coming later, Reno. It could be a one-vote election somewhere. Everybody vote. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Come right back.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Salem Now and Border Battle.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. You want to know why we're going to win Arizona? Go watch Border Battle. That's the SalemNow.com documentary produced by, six-part documentary produced by Charlie Kirk and Turning Point. And it will explain why Arizona is going to go red today. It's going to explain why Texas has never been closed for Beto. It's going to explain why Adam Laxalt's going to win in Nevada. Mike Lee in Utah, wherever the West has been deeply impacted by illegal immigration and by vast numbers of migrants. And you can have great love in your heart for the stranger. You can say all that you want about the necessity for good folks, especially Christians, have to reach out to the stranger and try and provide. And we support a church that does that in San Diego. But I'll tell you right now, that is not up to dealing with an open border. And that's driving a lot of votes, as is crime, as is education. If your school is closed today, that's because your teachers union negotiated a day off so they could help Democrats get elected, so they could keep control of your school's curriculum, keep it shut down during the COVID, make sure they're taught wacky things in K through 6. If your schools are actually closed today, you should be very angry. We should have the schools open every single day except Thanksgiving, Christmas, and they should go all summer, because we screwed our kids, completely screwed our kids with the COVID lockdown. And time to remember, today on the school board races, not one incumbent gets your vote, not one, unless you are rock, absolutely certain that they are against ever doing again what they did to the kids in the last 2.5 years. I'm going to go back to the audio. Kevin McCarthy on CNN. Kevin McCarthy showing up over at CNN. CNN has a better chance of booking Kevin McCarthy than does the Chamber of Commerce. That's what I find to be so amusing. The Chamber of Commerce has been so bad that Kevin McCarthy would rather go on CNN and talk to them than show up at a chamber meeting. We've got to get a new Chamber of Commerce leadership after this election so that they can work with it. Everyone in the C-suite should resign after the, because the Republicans will never work with them. They will never work with them. They ought to go out and get Doug Ducey or someone else who's being termed out and get them to come to town and revamp that organization. Let me go to Kevin McCarthy on CNN last night, cut number 9.
Well, I think anywhere over 20 is a red wave. And what's interesting is, think about where we're sitting right now. Think about the quality of the candidates that have been recruited from Rhode Island to Maine, New Hampshire, Connecticut. These are just places I've been traveling recently, from Ohio, from Oregon, from Washington, Nevada, California. I see more competitive races than I've seen at any given time. I see Democrats spending money in seats that Biden won by 20 points. New York. And why is it competitive? Cost of living, crime, the inflation, the lost learning through COVID. That's why a parent's bill of rights, I would like to see Democrats join with us. Let's empower the parents to have a say in their kids' education.
After Democrats got a boost from abortion this summer, did you guys change your game plan at all, or was it sticking to the plan from the beginning?
Our plan from the beginning was always the same. Create a path for a plan for a new direction for America. We spent, as you know, the last year and a half working on solutions, listening to the American people, and then presenting them. And we presented the commitment to America and have campaigned across this country. And we want America to decide which direction they want to go. Do they want getting on this path of inflation, of more crime, defunding of the police, of a DOJ that goes after parents, no accountability in Washington? Or would they like a new plan? And the thing I'd like to point out is, it is the commitment to America. It's not the commitment to the Republican Party. It's the commitment to America, to all Americans, to make this nation stronger. And that commitment is, we'll work with everyone that wants to make America better.
Speaker McCarthy, soon to be Speaker Designate McCarthy, is going to be a terrific speaker. He is a man of the legislative caucus, from his time in California through his many years in the vineyards in the Republican Congress, through his time as majority leader, and now as speaker. He is going to be a tremendous speaker, as is Steve Scalise. He's going to be a tremendous majority leader. They know what they're doing. They know how to keep a caucus together. McCarthy goes on talking about rhetoric, cut number 10.
Well, the first thing, I'll ask the president not to call half the nation idiots or challenge them or say things about them simply because they have differences of opinion. There's a number of people in this country that I have a difference of opinion on. I respect them. I respect their ability to debate. I respect their ideas. Let the idea win at the end of the day. I think leadership matters, and I think it probably starts with the president, and it'll start with the speaker as well.
What about members of your own party? who have spread some of these conspiracy theories that have resulted in some of this violence.
Yeah, I've watched people on both sides of the aisle. As Speaker, I'll be the Speaker for the whole House. So it won't be looking at just Republicans. It'll look at Democrats as well. You know, if Maxine Waters tells people to go get in their faces, we've watched this so many times before, and I appreciate you bringing them up, too, because as Speaker of the House, I will look at all.
Will they get committee assignments? Are you willing to kick some Democrats off of their committee assignments?
Well, I've been very clear that Eric Swalwell will not serve on Intel. The knowledge that I have based upon the friendship that he had with a Chinese spy, and if he cannot get a security clearance in the private sector, he should not be given the government security clearance either. Adam Schiff should not be serving on Intel either. After lying to the American public and after missing as the chair of Intel what was going on in Afghanistan and others just to play politics, I think that's wrong as well.
I just love the fact that I don't know who the CNN interviewer is. I don't recognize her. She brought up abortion. It was just Democratic talking points. All right, just Democratic talking points. CNN does not know how to change. It's like in their DNA to be anti-Republican. But Kevin went anyway, and the speaker's going to be a great speaker. Katie Hobbs, the worst candidate of the cycle of 2022, who's going to get crushed for governor in Arizona, gave a Zoom interview yesterday. She wouldn't debate. She wouldn't do any real interviews with any real journalists. So she gave a Zoom interview yesterday, cut number 11.
Well, look, I've said this from the get-go that these kind of things are nothing more than political stunts that aren't really solving issues at the border. And now our state is going to be embroiled likely in a legal battle because the governor has made it clear he's not interested in removing complying with the request to remove these containers, which he put on federal land, I think probably on purpose to instigate this kind of legal battle that now Arizonans are going to pay the price for. We've already paid $12 million in taxpayer dollars for these shipping containers, which is nothing more than a political stunt, and we need real solutions. That's why two border sheriffs
I cannot believe that here we are in election, and she's still doing up-talking. Our friend Dana Perino wrote a whole book on don't up-talk. Young ladies, and Katie Hobbs is not a young lady. She's a mid-career professional, and she's up talking. Oh, wow, horrific candidate. Gretchen Whitmer addressed the people yesterday, and listen for what you think is unusual in this. Cut number 13.
Bipartisan tax cut will help reduce the economic burden of the cost of menstrual products, especially for lower-income Michiganders. Saving people with a period from paying taxes on up to $4,800 in spending over the course of their lifetime.
You know, I just think that people who have periods are best referred to as women. But that is how crazy Gretchen Whitmer is. Kathy Hochul, the accidental governor in New York, also gave an interview yesterday to Press Gaggle. Cut number 12.
We got election day. It's all that matters.
Governor!
Check the source. You know, he has been hyperventilating, trying to scare people for months. And New Yorkers are onto it. All the legitimate media organizations have called him out for what he is doing, fear mongering. And it's not just here in New York. That has been the Republican playbook all across this country. All you need to know is that the Democratic states are safer than Republican states. Check out the facts.
But Governor.
You betcha. Democratic states are safer than Republican states. You betcha. New York City, just like Warren, Ohio. New York City, just exactly like, I'm trying to think of a big city that's run by a Republican, and so it's hard to come up with an answer there. But I did like Jerry Nadler standing next to her like a guest star in a Star Trek episode. You always knew it. Right when there was a guest star that they were going to get off, and Jerry Nadler standing there looking like death warmed over, knowing this is going to be a bad night. Kamala Harris, who threw lots and lots and lots of people into jail over marijuana, cut number 14 at a California rally. The Vice President of the United States, who is from California, is campaigning in California for desperate Democrats. Cut number 14.
Because you voted and said, hey, nobody should have to go to jail for smoking weed. We're now dealing with that because you voted.
I don't even know. Can we play that again? I hope you can see this. I don't know how she ended up as the vice president. I thought she was pretty good, and she's steadily declined in her inability to deliver a line. Can we play that again? Cut number 14.
Because you voted and said, hey, nobody should have to go to jail for smoking weed.
Smoking weed. Golly. It's like they're giving us gifts. Kellyanne Conway with Larry Kudlow yesterday, summing up this election cycle, cut 15.
Yes, the Democrats ran on what they want you to believe. The Republicans ran on what you can see with your own two eyes. And voters are smart enough, Larry, to vote according to what they see. It is a decline in everyday wealth and in what your wages are worth, obviously, an increase in crime, a big problem with our education overhang. A lot of parents are still very upset about the declining test scores, about the inability for them to find a better choice for their children. And of course, it's immigration and border security. I mean, 10 years after Romney blew it, and we had that autopsy by the Republican National Committee then under different leadership, that was all nonsense compared to where the immigration issue has gone since, where Steve Kornacki at his board last week on MSNBC was showing a Gallup poll plus 33 for the Republicans on which party do you trust more on handling immigration.
It's across the board. And look, America, do not take it for granted. We get one chance to course correct, or this inflation will get more deeply embedded. And you don't want to live through this. I did. I'm 66 years old. I came out of college in 1978 in the middle of the Carter years. Luckily, my dad gave me a used car. And I drove across the country and had a job, and I lived on grilled cheeses at the beach. And when you're 22 years old and footloose and fancy free, you can do that. Because there weren't many jobs around, but I got one, and I was happy to do that. And I'm very glad. Then I went to law school after two more years. And so I avoided the worst of it. We still had to buy our first house, though, when it was 12.5% 30-year interest rate. And the Carter economy took 4 years to recover from. 4 years of Reaganomics to recover from that. And that's where we are right now. It's a pretty bad situation, and it's not getting any better. It's not going to get any better any soon, because Dems just don't understand economics. They just don't. They think they can print money. Relief factor. I got my 6 miles in yesterday, listening to a book, the author of whom I'll be interviewing a little bit later today. And I got a lot of miles in, but that was a 6-3-6 three-day walk, and that's not really... not the right amount of for me. So I hear a little bit sore on election day, but I've got to get some sleep, and I got to get over to the big studio. I got to work with Larry O'Connor tonight, which is very, very disappointing. It's very, very sad. But we'll be working from 7 to midnight, and the Salem News Channel will be up and running if you want to watch on your app. If you want just straightforward, we're partnered with Election Decision Desk, so we'll be giving you good information. But I'm taking my relief factor early, and I might take it late because it's just such a pain in the neck with working with Larry O'Connor that maybe relieffactor.com will work. Larry O'Connor is really a pain in the neck, and working with Larry O'Connor, I just can't understand it. Now, coming up next hour, I have Virginia Governor Glenn Youngkin joining me, and I'm about to appeal Larry's designation as ambassador to the Virginia wine country as illegitimate. I may have to sue Governor Youngkin, but he's joining me. Ronna McDaniel is joining me. Herschel's going to be along. I have a special guest in hour three, a very special guest. You do not want to miss that. Florida Senator Rick Scott is next, America. We run through the races for the last time with the chair of the National Republican Senatorial Committee. Come right back to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Birch Gold Group.
Welcome back, America, on Election Day. I'm Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway. Join us tonight on the Salem News Channel for election coverage from 7 to midnight. Now, on all these radio stations and the Salem News Channel, the hardest working man not on the ballot in America is Senator Rick Scott of Florida, chair of the Republican National Republican Senatorial Committee. He is indefatigable. He joins us again. Good morning, Senator Scott. Are you glad or are you nervous this morning that it's over?
Well, I'm excited. I'm excited to watch what the voters do. I think the voters are going to come out and say, they need a Republican majority in the Senate. As you know, we have great candidates. They run great races. The Biden agenda is terrible. And so I think the voters are gonna come out and reward good government, reward Republicans for the fighters for good government. So I'm excited, actually, about today. We've got a great chance to get 52-plus, and I think we're
going to... Let's run down the scoreboard, if we can. Georgia, what's your number in Georgia, Senator Scott?
We're going to win without a runoff.
Good news.
Run a great race.
North Carolina.
Oh, Ted's going to win. I would bet Ted wins by 5. I don't know. He's run a great race. And Sherry Beasley's a radical lefty.
New Hampshire, Don Bulldog.
I think Don's going to pull it off. That shows you what grassroots does. He's been doing these town halls for 4 years. Maggie Hassam is somebody that has voted the wrong way consistently. So I think Don's going to pull it off. He's run a hell of a race. That guy's just relentless. 10 tours in Afghanistan. General, 10 tours in Afghanistan. This guy's a patriot.
All right, let's go over to Pennsylvania because this is where the polls divide and where Republicans are very confident and Democrats think they have a shot. What do you think, Senator Scott?
We're going to win. We're not going to win by a lot. We're going to win by 2. Memenoz had a very tough primary, but he's defined his opponent. We've helped him. Everybody has helped him, and he's running a great race, and he's going to win by a couple.
Oh, over in Ohio, I think J.D.'s got this locked up, but I just want to confirm that with you.
Yeah, J.D.'s going to win.
And Missouri, Eric Schmidt's got that locked up?
Yeah, Eric's got that locked up.
Okay, Wisconsin is the last Republican they were shooting at. I think Ron Johnson's going to win by 5, but what do you think?
He's going to win by a lot. I mean, here's a guy that's never been ahead in a poll in his life. Even the liberal polls have him up 4 or 5.
Yeah, it's pretty funny.
Ron's relentless.
He is. He's another indefatigable energizer bunny. Okay, Arizona, Blake Masters opened the show today. Sounds pretty upbeat. What do you think?
He's going to win. He's run a great race. Kerry Lake has run a great race. We defined Kelly early. Kelly's never come back. People care about border security. They care about all this fentanyl. And Kelly's voted 3 times against border security down there, done nothing for border security. It's a big deal. So I think Blake's going to win. There's been a lot of outside support, but Blake's run a great race. He's a hard worker.
Let's go just up a little bit to Nevada. This is very interesting because they've got terrible weather today in Reno. I hope people vote early. Adam Laxalt seems to me to be cruising, but John Ralston, who hates Adam Laxalt, just can't bring himself to say so. What do you say, Rick?
He can't, can he? No, Adam's going to win. He's been consistently up in the polls. You know, the key there is Adam's going to do really well with the Hispanic vote. I think we have a good chance to get the governor's race there. And I think those two together help they help each other. So I think we're going to win both the governor's race and the Senate race there. Sure looks like it, at least.
Okay. The two long shots are Colorado and Washington State.
Oh, gosh, yeah. There's really three.
What's the third?
I'd say Colorado.
Colorado, Washington State.
Connecticut? Leora Levy's a tireless worker. That's a hard one, but she's been working her butt off. But I think Tiffany Smiley's going to pull it off. She has just been relentless, and she's defined Patty Murray. And she's an advocate. She's a hard worker. She's got a great story, and she's told it well. She's relentless. I think she's going to pull it off. I think if we get the vote, if the votes come out the way it looks like they are, I think Joe Day's going to pull it out. It'll be close, but Joe Day's running a great race. He's got a wonderful family, great background. I'm very optimistic right now. If you look at the polls, if you look at the turnout, you look at the quality of the candidates, the problems that the Democrats have defining the Biden agenda, I think we're going to have a hell of a day.
Now, Senator, I want to finish by talking about Latinos and blacks because the Wall Street Journal said yesterday 18% of blacks are going to vote for Republicans, which will be astonishing. That'll be a high watermark of my lifetime. And that the Latino vote will be within 5 points, which is another high watermark of my lifetime. What do you attribute this to?
Talking to them. I mean, it's one thing. They, you know, first off, people are not voting because of their skin color. They're voting because they care about their family. They care about, they have a faith in God. They have, you know, they want a good job. They don't like inflation. They would like to have better schools. They'd like to have lower crime. They woke, you know, a lethal, not a woke military. These are things they're voting on. And when they do that, saying, oh, yeah, my skin color is this, so I'm going to have to vote this way. They're not. So they know the Republicans are better for them. I've always won the Hispanic vote. We put a lot of effort into it. We have a group called Operation Vamos in 9 states. The RNC has done an unbelievable effort to try to get out minority votes. And so everybody together has gone after and said, you guys aren't, everybody should vote with us because we're better for your families. And guess what? People realize it and they're going to vote with us. I think it's especially, if you think about it, when we win the Hispanic vote, it's going to be very difficult for us to lose. And we're going to win. I've won the Hispanic vote. It was very difficult for my Democrat opponent to beat me. That's going to happen around the country. And African Americans are, they're starting to come our way more and more every day. We got to get out there and talk to everybody, Asians, everybody.
Senator Rick Scott, always a pleasure. You've done a magnificent job, and you have been, again, tireless, and I appreciate it as a Republican. Good luck tonight. We'll talk again after this week is over. Rick Scott from Florida led the NRSC to what looks like a very good map in the Senate, a path back to the majority. We'll talk again soon. Don't go anywhere, America. Hour number 2, Ronna McDaniel, Governor Youngkin, lots ahead, Herschel, and a special surprise guest in Hour 3 here on The Hugh Hewitt Show. Morning, Glory America. Bonjour. Hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway, reminding you tonight, Salem Radio, Salem News Channel, will be live from 7 o'clock till midnight, and then we will hand it off to our West Coast friends to continue through the night. I hope you will tune in at this great radio station or download the Salem News Channel app and watch us. We're partnered with Decision Desk to bring you all the news as it occurs. Ronna McDaniel is chairwoman of the GOP. I don't know where she spends tonight. Do you go up into the command center at RNC headquarters, Ronna McDaniel, or do you stay in Michigan?
No, I will be in D.C. with our team watching results. I am not somebody who likes to be at parties on election night. I like to be in the war room getting results in real time, so that's where I will be tonight. I'm in Pennsylvania right now, about to go to a diner with Mehmet Oz.
Oh, give Dr. Oz our regards. He turned out to be a terrific campaigner, by the way. I'm not sure that people know how to develop that skill set late in life, but he got it. Selena Zeno followed him around throughout the summer where he learned how to do that, which is it's a skill set.
He did, and he works so hard. He's just every day out there meeting the people of Pennsylvania. And I'll say this, Pennsylvania is an election day voting state. We had a rally last night with over 2,000 people, or close to 2,000. And I asked the audience, how many of you have voted? And literally not a single hand went up. So everybody needs to go vote today, vote.gop to find your place. But Pennsylvania is going to be a big, big day of election day voting to put Oz over the top.
Chairwoman McDaniel, the Wall Street Journal wrote yesterday, their last poll, that 18% of black Americans are voting Republican and close to a majority of Hispanics are going to vote Republican. I'm not surprised given the effort that the party has put into organization, but are you surprised by that 18% number?
I'm not. I mean, what have the Democrats given you to vote for? When you look at high inflation, which is everything, right? Groceries, gas, rent. When you look at the drug crisis, our kids have been left behind by these lockdowns. On every single issue, the Democrats have failed, and the American people right now are about to deliver them their report card. And the communities that have been hurt the most, in a lot of cases, have been minority communities. You look at Detroit, test scores went down 12 points with kids that were out of school 51% of the year in 2021. That's the Wall Street Journal that put that out. If I were a mom in Detroit, I would be so mad about that. I am a mom in Michigan. My kids were that way, and I'm so mad about that. Why would they give Democrats another chance?
As chair of the Republican Party, though, you must get together with past chairs like Reince Priebus and Ed Gillespie. And you've got to say to them, you know, you guys, you did a good job, but you didn't have a president working for you like Joe Biden has been working for me, promising to shut down coal plants and stop drilling. Really, how many gifts can he give you in the last weekend, Ronna McDaniel?
I know. He is the gift that keeps on giving. I mean, none of the candidates want to campaign with him. But I will say this, you know, we've had great chairs of the RNC and who've done a lot. And Ryan preceded me. And one of the things that we learned is we have to reach out to minority communities. We have to show up in places where our party has not been. And this year, in this cycle, we have had 38 community centers open in black, Asian, and Hispanic communities a year before the election. And this is a true investment where we are going in and saying, we do not want to expect your vote. We want to earn your vote. And the Democrats have taken it for granted, and it's time for a change. And I think that's going to be a big part of some of these big wins in Texas, Florida, Nevada, and other states.
Yeah, you know, Chairwoman, I'm watching Hung Cao in Virginia only because it's close to where I am, and I talked to a precinct captain, Penny, and she thinks it's very close. He's a D-12 district, right? He should not be close. But you got a Navy captain, SEAL, immigrant to the United States, a refugee from Vietnam, goes to Africa, comes back, serves the country for 20-plus years in combat in perilous situations. If you get Hung Cao over the line, that means all night long it's going to be a red wave.
Yeah, there's some races we're going to be watching. Obviously, the East Coast is going to come in first. Alan Fung in Rhode Island 2, George Logan in Connecticut, Tom Kane Jr. in New Jersey. But if Virginia, I think Jen Kiggins is going to win. But if we win with a Yesley Vega and a Hung Cao, that means we're going to have a very strong night and probably pick up a lot of seats across the country.
I'm also going to be looking for Bruce Polquin up in Maine. So talk to me a little bit about Nevada. We got a snowstorm coming in Nevada. Adam Laxalt is ahead in every poll, even though John Rolston cannot bring himself to acknowledge reality because he hates Adam Laxalt so much for whatever reason. I don't know. It's just so funny. It's like a nervous tick.
I know. There's a Hatfield and the McCoys.
I don't get it, but Adam's going to win anyway if people vote. But you got a snowstorm. What do you do on a snow day if you're the RNC chair?
you say go vote, stay in line. We need you to stay in line and go to vote.gop. But nobody can leave. And I think our voters in Nevada are going to stay in line. They are committed. They understand. They have 16% inflation in Nevada. They're living under Sisolak. Cortez Masto's been a disaster. So they're going to vote for Lombardo, Laxalt, April Becker, Robertson, Sam Peters. We've got a great ticket in Nevada.
How do you remember all these names, Chairwoman McDaniel? I mean, it kind of gets hard.
I do remember them. I do remember them all. I mean, I shouldn't say that because then you're going to quiz me, but they're personal to me. I say to these people, I think about you all the time, all your races, and getting to campaign with them and meet their families and the sacrifice they give. It's very personal for me, and we're very dedicated to helping them get across the finish line and be one small part of their success.
All right, I want to close by talking about California because I lived there for so long. Mike Garcia is personal to me. Scott Baugh is personal to me. All these people, Dave Valadeo is personal to me. How do you think, hey, it's raining like mad in California today, so I don't know what that does. They got some good top of the ticket with Lonnie Chen and Nathan Hochman. How do you feel about the congressionals in California?
So I think there's some pickups there. I mean, you got a whole Valadeo and Garcia, and then, you know, Youngkin and Michelle Steele. But I think Duarte could be a surprise in California. And then you look at Scott Baugh, who's going against Katie Porter. Boy, she's got a lot of money. But Scott Baugh's run a really good race. And then you got Brian Marriott running against Levin. So I think there's a lot of opportunity in California. I think we actually could get some pickups in California. Of course, we won't know for a while. But the numbers that we're seeing look good. They look in line with us keeping the seats that we have. Mike Garcia is obviously in a tough race. He's probably the number one target for the Democrats there, but I think it looks good.
Okay. Let me conclude by asking you about state houses, which I do not follow as closely as I do the Senate. I'm in D.C., so I follow the federal election. I don't even know how many we have. I know that Doug Ducey's been running a great operation with you for the Republican Governors Association. What is your likeliest pickup, not hold, but pickup among the governorships, if there is one?
Oh, I think Draven in Oregon. She's run a really great race. This will be the first time a Republican's won in Oregon for 40 years. And we've got some other great candidates, but that would be the biggest pickup. But Sarah Sanders is going to win. I think Tudor Dixon in Michigan could surprise us with the win. You've got Tim Michaels running in Wisconsin, running a very good race against Evers. So there's pickups. DeWine's going to win handily. Ron DeSantis is going to win handily. Brian Kemp, obviously everybody's watching. If he gets above 50%, we avoid a runoff in Georgia. But that could also help Herschel. I think one of the things that's been very helpful, and then Carrie Lake. I mean, Carrie Lake's
a rock star. Yes, that's a whole. Yeah, that's a whole.
She is a rock star. I mean, I think she's going to win too. But Carrie helps Blake Masters. Lombardo helps Laxalt. They're all working in tandem together. DeWine helps JD. Kemp helps Herschel. DeSantis and Marco, Michaels and Ron Johnson. So the whole team is working very cohesively, and I think that helps us up and down the ticket in these battleground states.
All right,
so
you've got to go
to vote.gop, and you got to go vote.
VoteGOP, got to go to votegop.com. Now, I have one conspiracy theory to ask you, Ronna McDaniel.
Okay,
I think you recruited Katie Hobbs. I really do. I think you brought Katie Hobbs into this election. She's the worst Democratic candidate. She is the worst candidate in the country. You're sure you didn't go to her in a different, you know, put on Mufti or something and go and persuade her to go?
You know, Hugh, I'm a politician. I love taking credit for everything, but I wish I can't take credit for Katie Hobbs. She gets to take credit for that all herself, which I don't know if that's credit or what is it.
Whoever ran her campaign, do you think they'll ever work again?
I hope so.
I hope so, too.
They work on every Democrat race from now on.
Oh, Ronna McDaniel, you've been a great chair again. Congratulations. Have a great nail-biting day, and I hope I talk to you soon after the election, friend.
Thanks, Hugh. Take care. Go to vote.gop. All right.
Vote,
bye, guys.
Go to vote.gop. Vote.gop. Thank you, Chairwoman McDaniel. Generalissimo, she's going to make her goals, but I'm not sure you are. MyPhDWeightLoss.com gave you an extra day to get over to 50. And
nowhere in this
864-644-1900 864-644-1900
nowhere in this was there a time constraint.
Hey man, the light is on your head. Ouch, that hurt to watch.
Well,
so
I'm sorry.
That's a reflection there. So you're not, you haven't lost 50 pounds yet.
I am down to 191.5. I have a pound and a half to go.
A pound and a half.
I don't have to lose it.
I gave you two. You had two election
days. No, you
didn't. I gave
give
you two extra
me, you
days.
Didn't give me anything.
MyPhDweightLoss.com.
Are you going to stand at the end of the marathon with a sign saying, sorry, you didn't make it?
Well, look, they close the course sometimes. If you're not going to make 50, I mean, we gave you two extra days to election day. MyPhDweightLoss.com, Generalissimo.
Where they don't time you.
They don't time you, but they do encourage you.
Unlike some people.
Unlike radio hosts. I'll be right back, America. Head over to MyPhDweightLoss.com, great sponsor of the show. And indeed, Dwayne has lost 48 and a half pounds, but not 50. I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. I've got Governor Glenn Youngkin of Virginia coming up after the break. Herschel next hour, a special guest in the second half of hour number three today, so do not miss that. Very, very special guest. One of our great sponsors is Dr. Marty's Nature's Blend. You know, don't feed your dog garbage. A lot of dog food made with expired grocery store meat. A lot of people use wood pulp and artificial preservatives, not Dr. Marty's Nature Blend. Dr. Marty's, Ralphie was over yesterday because Ralphie the Wonder Dog came to see me yesterday for a variety of reasons, so I had Ralphie in. So he's looking around for Dr. Marty's Nature Blend. I didn't get out for him because I wasn't supposed to feed him. He's just hanging out with me. But boy, does he love it. He looks around for it, and that's because every dog, Lassie 1 and Lassie 2, Dwayne's dogs love it. Your dog will love it. Nature's Blend is pantry safe. It's easy to prepare. Give the dog the food that they will love, and they will love you even more, though that's often not possible. And right now, you save 54% off your dog supply of Nature Blend, and you receive a free pack of premium treats if you go to drmartypets.com/Hewitt. That's drmartypets.com/Hewitt. Or text Hewitt to 511-511. Hewitt, H-E-W-I-T-T, to 511-511. Message and data rates may apply. I also persuaded our friends over at the Salem websites to add a Dr. Marty's Nature Blend button at HughHewitt.com. Just scroll down. You know, it's interesting, speaking of adding a button, Twitter is doing amazing things. I don't know what's going on at Twitter, but I'm closing in on 200,000 people at a steady clip of adding a few hundred a day. If you want my updates throughout the night, you have to go over to Hugh Hewitt on Twitter. It's all I do. Where to watch? Kentucky and Indiana close first. Now, in Indiana's 1st Congressional District, Jen Ruth Green is running. She's a terrific Air Force vet. African-American woman, just an amazing candidate. I met her in Wyoming at Kevin McCarthy's gathering of first-time candidates. We've heard Jim Banks talk about Jen Ruth Green again and again and again. Jim Banks has been everywhere, man. He's been everywhere out there campaigning for people and mostly talks about Jen Ruth Green. Now, we will not know because that one will be a long time counting in Indiana. It's going to be close, but Jen Ruth Green can put it over at 7 p.m., At 7 p.m., we start to be able to figure out what's going on because Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, Virginia, and New Hampshire all close at that hour. And so if they can't call it for Maggie Hassan right away, that is big trouble for Democrats. They thought they're going to coast by 10 points there. Don Bolduc has made it a neck-and-neck race. I'm appealing to you, New Hampshire, get out there and vote. Do we have the Don Bolduc ad somewhere? Generalissimo, can you find that from last week? I want to play it one more time for the people of New Hampshire who are listening right now. Do not let other people decide how you should vote for yourself. Get out and vote. New Hampshire's got gorgeous weather today, I believe. No reason not to go enjoy it. Leave, stand in line, and get out there and vote for General Bolduc. In Georgia, you know, I know you're listening to me. You're going to work in Atlanta. There's no ice storm. That's happened on Election Day before. There's nothing to stop you from getting out and voting for Herschel. It would be great to avoid a runoff. I love Georgia, but I don't want to go down there. Unless the varsity is going to host me. And Glenn, would you please call everybody you know? My buddy Glenn is the Mr. Georgia Politics. Keep me posted on all this stuff. Virginia, the governor will tell you afterwards. We got three key races, but get out there and get it done. Let me check as well on markets this morning because I just like to see what Europe is doing as America votes. Brought to you by Birch Gold. Remember, if you're buying gold today, you go to hughgold.com or you text my name, Hugh, to 989898. And they'll sell it to you. $1,673.90 an ounce this morning. And mostly you want to open an IRA or 401k because now is the time to get into the market. And now is the time. Gold is not where it should be given the inflationary rate that we're going to have for the next 2 years. So I still think it's a terrific buy at $1,673 an ounce. And Birch Gold will take care of you at HughGold.com. So overseas this morning, it's mixed. All right. It's down a little bit in England. It's break even in France, and it's up a third of a point in Germany. So everybody's holding their breath. I mean, our allies want a Republican Congress. Everybody except our enemies want a Republican Congress. Mostly, though, you want a Republican Congress because you cannot afford another year of the inflation that we just had. And President Biden is completely unaware of what's going on in the country. I mean, when he walks out there and says, I've done a great job, I'm the best president ever, you just flabbergasted. He believes it. Not saying he's lying. He believes it sincerely. But you and I know inflation has not been this bad since I graduated from college, and that's a long time ago. I'll be right back, America. Stay tuned. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Election night coverage on the Salem News Channel. You can download the app today. Watch us all night. Beginning at 7 on these radio stations and the Salem News Channel app. Stay with us.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Dr. Marty's Nature's Blend.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. If you are just checking the Real Clear Politics numbers, the last set of polls came in last night. Herschel Walk. What's that? Is the governor joining us? Oh, Governor Glenn Youngkin joins us now. Hello, Governor. How are you?
I'm great, Hugh. Good morning. I hope you're well. It's going to be a big day across the nation as I think America sends a real clear wake-up call to Joe Biden.
It's going to be an echo of last year's your election, Governor. I think education is front and center on a lot of minds, and I want to start there. I think it's more than CRT. I think it's more than gender. I think it's actually just discussed with a lot of schools are closed today for Election Day. Teachers' unions negotiate that so that they can go out and work for Democrats, but it's going to remind every parent out there of school closures.
It is, and it's at the top of parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles' minds that not only have parents been pushed out of their children's lives, but on top of that, the standards were lowered, and the results of closed schools showed themselves in the national report card this year, where we had just extraordinary and heartbreaking learning loss across the nation. We saw it in Virginia, and where the parents' movement started here in Loudoun County, and it spread across the country. And I think Americans are going to stand up and make a very clear statement. We are in charge of our children. We're not just at the table. We're at the head of the table, and we expect our schools to help educate our children and not indoctrinate them.
Now, Governor, I'm feeling very good about Jen Kiggins down in Virginia Beach, but I also am very optimistic about Vega and about Hung Cao. What do you see when you go into those districts?
You know, I've been with them a ton over the last 3 weeks, and the momentum is extraordinary. And we had rallies yesterday where people were basically falling out of buildings and couldn't get them in parks. And it the momentum feels just like last year. And it's come on strong. And I think, again, this is not Republicans versus Democrats. This is Virginians standing up for the values that we hold dear, that they have seen the liberal Democrats violate time and time again: runaway inflation, unsafe neighborhoods, demeaning law enforcement, and undermining education. And Virginians are tired of it. They spoke loudly last year, and I think they're going to speak loudly again today. And I think that Jen and Yesley and Hung are going to make great, great congressmen from Virginia.
Now, Governor, you've been on the road as well. I know with Kerry Lake and other governors. Which ones are you going to be keyed in on tonight?
Well, interestingly, all of them. And what's happened as Americans have woken up is many, many states that folks thought were out of reach, like New York, like Oregon, all of a sudden are in reach. And I think we're going to see a big statement across the country. This big wake-up call is everywhere. And when you look at races like New York and Wisconsin and Michigan and Kansas and Nevada and New Mexico and Oregon, these folks are standing up strong and saying, we've had enough. We want a Republican governor. Republican governors have led so much better than Democrat governors, and every state deserves a Republican governor.
Kathy Hochul yesterday said that Lee Zeldin is hyperventilating over crime. I think that is another mistake by a mistake-prone candidate. I don't think you can hyperventilate over crime if you've actually been attacked on a stage by a man with a knife.
It just goes to show you, Hugh, that they're so out of touch with what's on Americans' minds, and people are worried about their safety. They can't make ends meet anymore. Hung Cao said yesterday, It's something to pay attention to when you're worried about your grocery bill becoming your mortgage payment. And that is what's happening across the nation. And crime has run away, and folks in New York cannot feel safe about going outside, and yet their current governor, Kathy Hochul, doesn't care. And this is what voters, not Republicans, but voters are hearing from the left liberal Democrats, is that we don't listen to you, we don't care about what you care about, and I think that's why Americans are about to send this huge wake-up call.
So, Governor, how do you spend Election Day when you're not on the ballot? What do you do?
Well, we're working on initiatives across the Commonwealth. We're making some key phone calls today, and most importantly, we're trying to make Virginia the best state in America, and that's what we're working on. And it's been amazing to watch us deliver on our day one game plan. And results have been just extraordinary. We will spend some time just making sure that everybody knows where to go vote and to get out and vote and to fully exercise this most important right that we have as Americans, to go vote and elect our leaders.
Now, Governor, I got a bone to pick with you. There's this Maryland guy named Larry O'Connor who went down to the Richmond, to the governor's mansion, got named the honorary ambassador to the wine country. Now, that's my shtick. I taught Larry that shtick. I had Arnold name me the sommelier of California, and Tim Pawlenty made me commissioner of hockey, and I was named warden of the Collegiate Peaks by Bill Owen. I think you need to revoke that. That man's a Marylander. You can't put him in a Commonwealth ambassadorship.
Well, the good thing is we can have multiple ambassadors. He did go through a rather extensive vetting program, and so I think that we're already on our way here, Hugh.
You didn't check with me. I wish the state police will come by. I'll tell you all you need to know about Larry O'Connor. Talk to me one more thing, Governor, in terms of the candidates that you have been out with and the press that is around them. I have watched them watch you looking for a mistake. Is American media broken? I mean, do they ever just report what the candidates say as opposed to lining it with... in Carrie Lake's case, they just cannot give an honest report about her.
The media is pretty tough, I have to say. Mainstream media, particularly, that comes in and already asks questions with an expected answer, and that's just the way it is right now. What I think I tried to do is speak to all the media and express clearly where we're going and how we're getting there and the success that we've had, and most importantly, is to make sure that we're also speaking to all Virginians, and I think that's my job. And sometimes the media makes it a little harder than I believe they should, but we try really hard to speak to the entire media spectrum and hopefully deliver a consistent message. I think part of what's going to be expressed today at polls around the nation is a frustration of the information that voters are being fed and Americans are being fed, and a real statement that says, we know what's going on. We know that inflation is running away from our paychecks, and we know that our neighborhoods aren't safe, and we know our schools aren't teaching our children what they need to know, and we know the border isn't safe and that fentanyl is flowing over in an unconstrained way and causing more overdoses than we can possibly imagine. And so voters are smart. Americans get it, and notwithstanding the constant spin coming from mainstream media, voters get what's going on, and they're going to express clearly today they're unhappy.
My last question, Democrats are a little bit lucky because heating bills have not yet begun to arrive. I don't know how the Commonwealth heats the majority of its homes, but up in the Northeast, it's heating oil. Those people are going to get walloped. What do you think is ahead in the energy market for the winter?
Yeah, I think it's going to be tough on everybody. You can see the preliminary signals of that with diesel costs in some places up over $6. And in New England, there's already shortages and major concerns from folks. And this is a result of Biden's failed energy policies and completely ignoring the fact that being energy independent was a huge national security advantage for the nation as well. And, Hugh, I think this is part of common sense getting back in the room. It's one of the reasons why we released our all-American, all-the-above energy policy for Virginia, which is to have abundant, affordable energy for everyone that, in fact, can be achieved without undermining goals to, yes, be cleaner, but let's be serious. We can't undo the great power progress that we have made with clean-burning natural gas at a time where we're going to need it in order to grow, and we're going to need it in order to heat homes, and we're going to need it in order to get the air conditioning on in the summertime and make sure that the NICU unit works at the hospital. When we turn the switch, the power has to come on. When we turn on the heat, the heat has to come out. And I think Joe Biden's really, really misplaced energy policy is going to hurt a lot of Americans this year.
Common sense getting back in the room. I love that phrase. And I think the president saying shutting down plants and stopping drilling is not common sense. Governor Glenn Youngkin, always a pleasure to talk to you, Governor. Keep coming back, and we'll do a postmortem with you soon after the election. I appreciate your time.
Thank you. Have a blessed day.
You too. We got a great governor in Virginia. And give yourself a great governor wherever you live. Vote for the Republican. Give yourself a shot at not having taxes go up, having education reform take place. This is the sleeper issue of this election. Elections are underway across the United States. I got some B-roll to play for you here. And the ability of people to vote is something you just can't take for granted. They're not voting, right, in China. They're not voting in North Korea. They're not voting in a number of places where we have got horrific dictatorships and actual tyranny. But they are voting across the United States this morning, and I'm encouraging all of you to please even if it's a pain in the neck, even if you forgot and you got halfway to work, turn around, go get the I voted sticker and put it up on your, you know, your boss will give you a break if you're 30 minutes late because you went to vote this morning. And you explain to him, I had to. It's about my kids. I got to get the schools open. I got to make sure that we are out there making sure that every single school board race is contested. And do not vote for one incumbent school board member, not one, in the United States. Just toss them all out unless you are absolutely certain that they were on behalf of parents, fighting for parents throughout the shutdown. Do not forget what drove you crazy in the United States. I'm thinking of my daughter here, being driven crazy by stop, start. This is going to be the quarantine. This isn't going to be the quarantine. Here are the rules. It was all crazy. And you're looking at a picture of Ron DeSantis right now on the Hugh Hewitt Salem News Channel feed. He's going to win by more than 10 points. Brian Kemp's going to win by 8 points. You're looking at Brian Kemp right now. Prop 3 is a nightmare in Michigan. Don't vote for Prop 3. I've got lots of different candidates out there, and we won't be able to. Charlie Crist, honest to goodness, Charlie Crist, that's the saddest guy running. Charlie Crist is the saddest guy running because he's been running forever. I've been on the radio for 23 years, and Charlie Crist has been running for 24. And whenever he gets above a safe blue district, he was a Republican who became an independent, who became a Democrat, who became a trial lawyer and was on billboards in Florida, and Ron DeSantis is just going to crush him today. But the key places where you got to vote, Nevada. There's a snowstorm headed into the Reno area, and I want you to get out and vote early so you can relax tonight. A lot of Democrats vote early in Nevada. Republicans don't so much. And the early vote looks pretty good for Republicans anyway in Nevada, but I don't extrapolate too much. It's the first time we have a new system for voting in Nevada, but Adam Laxalt will make a great senator, and it's time for Nevada not to get left behind in a Republican Senate. Leader McConnell will be Majority Leader McConnell by this time tomorrow morning, and you and I are both going to be very happy about that. I've already taken my relieffactor.com this morning. I've already done that, and I want to remind you, if you're going to be up late like I am, we're going to be going at this from 7 to midnight over on the Salem News Channel and at many of these great radio stations, including the one you're listening to right now, as we bring you live coverage of results from around the country. And the great thing about the radio is I don't have to queue up visuals. All I have to do is give you the information. The great thing about the Salem News Channel is that they've got great production values and they can do the B-roll and they can make it work. And you do not want to miss that. I love election night. I really do. I've always loved election night. I've loved election night since I'm old enough to remember election night. And the first one I can remember is 1974 when the Republicans got wiped out. I was working for Paul Cronin in my first election in Massachusetts when Paul Cronin was running for Congress. He got beat by Paul Zongas. It was tough for a freshman in college to lose the first election that they ever lost, but it was Watergate baby year. And wave elections, that was the first wave. That was a blue wave. Democrats won that. But then 1980, that was the most fun. Not only did Reagan win, but Howard Baker became the majority leader of the United States Senator. Maybe it was Bob Dole. I can't remember who took it. I think it was Howard Baker. And we just won everywhere. People didn't expect it. That could happen with Joe O'Dea and Tiffany Smiley tonight. It's going to happen with Blake Master. It's going to happen with Don Bulldog in New Hampshire. It's going to happen with Herschel. Get out there and vote for Herschel. Herschel is coming up at the top of the next hour. Don't go anywhere except right here. I'm going to come back with Charlie Dombek talking about Key City Capital. But don't forget, if you're going to go out, walk precincts today, do it with your relieffactor.com. All right, relieffactor.com. It is a great sponsor of this show. It's got its bug on my news feed because they keep us going every single day and they keep me going on long days like today. Relieffactor.com. Charlie Dombek is next, America. Stay tuned.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by Key City Capital.
Welcome back, America, on Election Day. Get out and vote, get out and vote, get out and vote. Charlie Dombek joins me with KeyCityCapital.com. I usually talk to Charlie every other week or so to check on my money, but I did that last week. I want to talk to him about a different thing. Good morning, Charlie. How are you?
Good morning, Hugh. Great to be here.
How's my money?
Your money's doing well. In fact, we have a new acquisition that we have in the works for a little bit later this year in December. It'll be one of the last acquisitions in Fund 11.
So I got to tell people, the due diligence that Charlie and his team do at QCityCapital.com is extraordinary. But I wanted to talk to him today. And if you want to invest and you want a good, this is not an offer to sell, just go get the prospectus from Charlie, be a qualified investor. Go to KeyCityCapital.com/Hugh and you'll get it. Charlie, I was reading Jim Garrity in the Washington Post yesterday, and he says on day one, Republicans will introduce legislation to rescind the permanent appropriation for 87,000 new Internal Revenue Service employees. Now, you are an accountant. One of the services you offer, as well as terrific investments in real estate properties and apartment complexes, is you do backwards accounting. You go back and look. What do you think these 87,000 new agents are going to do, Charlie?
Well, they are going to scour the average American's 1040s for additional revenue. And look, the Biden administration tried unsuccessfully on three different occasions to make substantial changes to the Internal Revenue Code that would have affected almost every American and would have resulted in a massive tax increase that maybe we haven't seen the likes of in generations. And as a result of his unsuccessful activities, he went to the concept of hiring a bunch of accounting police to raise more revenue. Look, the Democrats have been on a spending spree. They need more revenue. And the only way they can collect more revenue is by increasing enforcement. And literally, the IRS was going to be embedded with an army of accounting police for the sole purpose of chasing money and looking into our 1040s and trying to recover dollars that they need to boost the budgets based upon the massive spending that they've been planning.
Now, Charlie, when people hear me talk to you, usually it's about apartment complexes, guaranteed rates of return, the funds that you do and the complexes you buy, et cetera. But you also do this defensive accounting, looking backwards at where people have overpaid and preparing them for the future. How hard is that when you know that there's basically a Normandy landing of IRS agents coming if the Democrats don't get rolled back?
Well, it's quite easy. Look, I've been a practicing CPA for nearly 30 years, and I formed my own CPA firm about 20 years ago for the sole purpose of recovering dollars that clients unnecessarily pay in the form of state and federal income taxes. And many CPAs are really good historians. We tell the story. We tell you how much you make, how much you owe, when and where to file your taxes, and oftentimes how to write some pretty big checks at the last minute when you least expect it. So I simply do what many other accounting professionals don't. Number one is there is a book called the IRS Data Book that publishes all of the audit statistics. I know what the red flags are. I know what entity types are getting audited more frequently. I know how to protect people from what potentially would be a massive increase in IRS audits. I'm also a tax planner, so I know how to use the pieces on the tax chessboard in a way that strategically favors you rather than the government. It's as simple as taking the time to look back to the 1040s, see how you've been reporting your income, see how you've been playing, how you've been paying your taxes, and simply coming up with strategies that recover dollars. It's low-hanging fruit in many clients' financial lives. That's what I've been doing for a career of work.
Now, Charlie, when 87,000 new IRS employees arrive, normally a lot of IRS people are very reasonable, and they will work with people like you who are professionals. But when you get 87,000 newbies, what do you expect from them?
I expect from the people that are running the IRS a very aggressive stance on collecting back taxes and looking at your 1040s for any possible way to increase revenue. And look, many of these IRS agents are going to be armed. And again, as I said, it's the army of accounting police, and I expect a very aggressive stance. And during the COVID crisis, all collection activity was essentially stopped. I had an individual, a very high-profile entertainer, that had a corporation levied for over $300,000 in taxes for individual taxes. First time in the history of my work as a CPA over 30 years that I've ever seen a corporate entity levied for personal taxes.
Wow. You see, I think my theory is that newbies are going to be under pressure to deliver, and that they're not going to be particularly concerned with precision. And that's where Charlie Dombek and Key City Capital. Normally, I just tell you to consider their prospectus and investing with them if you want fixed income return and a potential capital gains on the other end. But today, I wanted to talk about that, given that Kevin McCarthy has said that's goal number one, to repeal those 87,000 agents. I just don't know if it's going to get past the president. He needs those agents, Charlie. He wants those agents. I think you're going to be busier than you've ever been. Charlie Dombek, KeyCityCapital.com/Hugh. Great sponsor of my show. Great guy to talk to. Charlie, thank you. KeyCityCapital.com/Hugh. Coming up, I'm going to talk with Herschel and then a very special guest at the bottom of the hour. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to SalemNewsChannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
Morning, Glory America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway, and it's Election Day. I'm joined by Herschel Walker, who's going to be the next senator from Georgia. Good morning, Herschel. Welcome back.
Hello there. How are you guys doing?
We are great, and you're going to be great, except for when Ohio State puts the hammer down on the Bulldogs come the playoffs. But how's it feel on the ground today?
Well, it feels pretty good. We're looking for a big win tonight, and I'm not sure if Ohio State going to beat the Dogs, but I think they can try. But the Dogs, they're going to win that game as well, just like I'm going to win tonight.
Okay, I can agree with you on half of that. I just talked to Rick Scott. He thinks you will avoid a runoff, that you'll get more than 50%. Is that what you're feeling?
I do feel that we can avoid a runoff. I think the people in Georgia, they're speaking loud, they're speaking clear, that they want to change. I think they're tired of this economy being the way it is, and you have people in that's in Washington, like Senator Warnock, that don't want to even address it. I mean, you have people that don't want to address the crime, don't want to address the economy, don't want to address the border, don't want to address men and women's sports. How can you fix it if you can't acknowledge that there's a problem? And I'm not saying that you know, when you're a leader and you see a problem, you need to fix the problem. But when you can't even admit that there is, how can you fix it? And I think that's the problem we have right now, is we have the people on the left that has created such a big, big problem in less than 2 years, and they don't want to admit it. So how in the world can they fix it if they can't admit it?
You have been out there with Brian Kemp. He is leading. You are leading. All the late polls show you ahead, which is remarkable since you've been behind in every poll until this weekend. But this is when the great hedge edge occurs and the media tries to catch up with reality. What has surprised you the most about this election, Herschel?
Well, you know, what surprised me, but it also brought joy, that a lot of people lost, sort of like they lost confidence in our elected officials because of what has been happening over the last couple of years. And by me going in to meet with a lot of people, going into their homes and sitting down talking to people, I gave them trust again, that you can trust people again, because I told them I'm going to go to Washington and fight for them. You know, this is not something I thought I would ever do. It's not something that I ever wanted to do. And but I can't sit back, you know, being a man of God, I can't sit back and let them pretend to try to destroy this country, destroy families. And I just say that God has blessed me, and if I can help, I'm going to try to help. And that's what I wanted to do.
Now, Herschel, I followed your race pretty closely because of my Atlanta affiliate, my Athens affiliate. I'm all over Georgia. The two things that stand out is when the MSNBC commentator, Ellie something or other, called you the Republican kind of Negro. I think that just really offended people. And then Raphael Warnock thought he was going to destroy you in the debate, and you cleaned his clock. Those are the two big moments for me. Is there anything else I'm missing?
Well, you know, right now, I think people have always underestimated me, and I think the people on the left continue to say lies and spread lies, but I noticed that they would do and say anything for power. And it's sad that Senator Warnock seemed to fall in that same category, being a minister, a man of God as well. But I think that debate showed the people of Georgia, I hope, who can be a leader right today. You know, he kept saying that I wasn't senatorial, I'm not prepared. Well, he wasn't prepared. He couldn't answer questions. He didn't want to answer questions. I had to answer some of the questions for him. And I think that's what people saw. And then when the people and the news media want to continue to call me these awful, awful names, you know, I'm not into the name calling. Right now, what I'm concerned about is the crime on the street. I'm concerned about this economy, this open border, men and women's sports. That's what I want the people to know about. You know, I'm not going to get into the name calling because that's irrelevant. You know, I'm very proud of everything that I've done in my life. I've had my ups and downs, but one of the things people can know about me is I've always gotten up and done the right thing, and I will continue to do that. So that's the way God has blessed me. That's the way I was raised from my parents. And I will continue to fight for that America's dream for everyone in the state of Georgia, because I've gotten that dream. And I know it is possible if we continue to keep this country, the country that everyone has fought to give us the liberties and freedoms that we have, rather than changing it to the type of country that the left and Senator Warnock wanted to be.
You know, you closed the weekend over at the dog game, and they saluted the late coach Vince Dooley, who cut his last ad for you. It's sad, but it's also sweet that the coach got in one last encouragement of you. How was that remembrance for him in Athens this weekend?
Well, you know, that was absolutely great, and I'm glad that they remember, Mr. Trippett and Coach Dooley. it meant so much to the University of Georgia. And, you know, it was a bittersweet moment, you know, for him to do the ad, the last ad. And, you know, I was going to pull it. I was going to pull that ad. And Miss Dooley said, no, said that he wanted to do that for you. But, you know, no one knew that was going to be his last ad. And, you know, I spoke to him a couple of days before, and he had, you know, said to win this thing, Herschel, you go out and win it, but you never think that may be the last time you ever talk to someone. And that's why I said, you know, your loved ones, always love them and tell them how much you love them and stuff. And, you know, the lose Coach Dooley, you know, it was tough. And my heart goes out to Miss Dooley, you know, like I said, their mom and dad. And if it wasn't for Coach Dooley, there may have never been a Herschel Walker. You know, when I first got to Athens, I sort of was scared to death of him because he was so stern, so straight. But one thing about it, he was just like my parents. That's the way my parents raised me. They raised me to be straightforward. They raised me to be disciplined and respectful. And that's the way Coach Dooley was. And I thank him and Miss Dooley for that because they kept me on the straight and narrow. And I think that's what's been so great in my life. And the Lord has blessed me to have coaches in my life that was just like that with Coach Landry. Same type of coach. They were straight. This is the way they wanted it done. You're going to be respectful. You're going to act like this. You got to do this. And I think that was great because they taught you that respect. And that's what has carried me all through my life.
Herschel, I hope you bring this attitude to the United States Senate because it's gentlemanly, and I appreciate it. There's probably no one least likely not to run through the end zone as you. I think you will run through, but how is Election Day going to roll out for Herschel Walker? I know you run through the tape through the end zone, but how are you doing it?
Well, you know, what I'm doing is I'm trying to get people out to vote because, you know, I want everyone to know that their vote need to be counted, their voices need to be heard because this is one of the most important elections, I think, in our lifetime. I want people to know that the left are really, really trying to change the fabric of this country. They really trying to change it. And I'm not just saying this. They're trying to change it. You can see what's happening when they're putting men and women sports. They're having this border wide open. You see how they want to have these no cash bail, this releasing prisoners out of jail. And they're like, wait a minute, what country are we living in? You know, what are they doing? And we got to stop that. And it starts tonight. It starts right like today. You get out and vote. You get out and have your voices heard, your vote counted, because we have to fight this. And, you know, people just want to live their lives. They just want to be able to, you know, go buy groceries, go to the store, take care of their family, take their kids to school, not worry about putting critical race theory in the schools, and, you know, just pay your bills, not having the government to run your life. And that seemed like that's what the left want to do. They want to run your life.
Well, Herschel Walker, great. You've done this show many, many times. I thank you for being so accessible, as I know you've been to all the media. And good luck today and good luck tonight. Thank you for joining me again, Herschel.
And God bless you guys. Thank you so much.
I hope you'll say that after the Buckeyes beat down the Bulldogs, but we'll see.
I don't think that's going to happen. I think we're still going to be happy.
We'll see, Herschel. Thank you for joining me. Don't go anywhere, America. I got lots more coming up. It's Election Day. Do not forget to vote, especially in Nevada, where it is snowing in Reno. Adam Laxalt should win by 4, 5, maybe 6 points, but not if people don't show up on Election Day. So I'm making a particular appeal. I'm on live right now in Reno and on live right now in Las Vegas. And I know you're worried about the weather out there in California. It is going to rain. Has it begun to rain yet, Generalissimo? Has it started coming down, Skinny Dash?
I got to open up the door. I don't know.
Okay, I'm curious. By the way, have you got my next guest typed yet?
No, I don't have my next guest typed yet.
All right, just checking.
I can probably start with the first two words.
No, you can't. Don't even give away. We're not giving any surprises away. You got to come back and listen to another segment before we do that. I do, however, want to remind everyone out there what the President of the United States had to say on Friday in, where was he in Friday when he talked about it? I guess he was in, well, first let's play Don Bulldog, if we've got that. Let's got the Don Bulldog ad for our New Hampshire audience. It's really
in the early days after 9/11, he went to Afghanistan to hunt terrorists. General Don Bulldog, a true American hero, one of the legendary Lions of Kandahar. Bulldog survived a 2,000-pound bomb explosion and a helicopter crash that almost killed him, until someone handed him a rifle to fight his way out. 10 tours of duty, 5 bronze stars, 2 purple hearts. The first general in American history to come forward with PTS, Baldick inspired thousands in uniform to get the critical help they need. General Don Baldick has made the motto of our state the story of his life. Now Baldick is on a new mission to take on the corrupt Washington career politicians in both parties and turn this great country around. General Don Baldick, a true American hero for New Hampshire.
I'm Don Baldick, and I approve this message.
Paid for by
Don Baldick for US Senate. I love that ad probably more than any other ad because of the announcer's voice and because of the record. 6 bronze stars. Or Maggie Hassan, you choose New Hampshire. I'll be right back. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. Election day is dawning bright and clear across most of the United States. The only trouble spots are in California. Heavy rain and flash flooding likely across parts of southern and southwestern California today. And heavy mountain snow is going to continue through Wednesday night for the Sierra Nevada, the Intermountain West, and Northern Rockies. So if you're in Nevada, go vote early and then get home and watch the returns come in. Make sure you get out there for Adam Laxalt. And in Utah, you're going to get some snow. Get out there for Mike Lee. I'd like Mike Lee to win by 20 points because I think it's all been nonsense. Evan McMullen is a Democrat, is running as an independent, going to caucus with a Democrat. So he says he's not a Democrat and he's not going to caucus with the independents. It's a dishonest campaign. And Mike Lee is a good senator. He's done a very good job. He's written some very good books. He's a serious guy. And Utahns, get out there and vote for him. Get it done. Get it done. AndrewandTodd.com, great sponsors of the show, will lend you money to buy a house. And today is a good day to, by the way, go house shopping because nobody else is. All the geeks are out there watching the election returns and working the polls. But AndrewandTodd.com are working your loans. They're with Sierra Pacific Mortgage. They go from soup to nuts. They process your loan. They get it done. They make it happen. You can lock in a rate. They have special programs, 2111. Ask them about that to make it more affordable for you to get in this first 2 years. It's very hard with interest rates climbing almost by the day. So you don't want another day, and you want to help your son or daughter become a homeowner, become a non-occupying co-borrower with them. Also, if you're a senior and the Biden economy has crushed you, and a lot of you have been crushed by it, ask them about reverse mortgages, or if your mom or dad is just pressed to the wall and their Social Security is not enough to make up for it in this inflationary spiral that Joe Biden set off with the Democratic Congress, then call them at AndrewandTodd.com, 888-1172, and say, talk us through the reverse mortgage. Tell us how we get money out of the house, never have to make another house payment. Do have to pay your taxes every year. Don't ever want to mislead anyone. It's not olly-olly in for you. You still got to pay your taxes, your homeowner association. But no more mortgage payments. You get equity out. You bank the equity. You live off the interest. It helps every single month. That's what you ought to be doing. That's what you ought to be doing right now. And you can do it with AndrewandTodd.com. I got a special guest coming up after the break. And so I want to tell you about Relief Factor now. All right. There's my bag. I already took it this morning. But whenever I have a special guest and I talk through the break and I put it up later over at HughHewitt.com, I want to make sure that I don't forget to tell you about ReliefFactor.com when I get carried away with one of my in-depth interviews. This one's going to be special, so do not miss a minute of it. You want to come back after the break for my surprise guest. But in the meantime, ReliefFactor.com is out there to make your day better, especially if you're a poll. If you're Penny and you're at the polls, sit down. You're going to be poll watching all day long, and I hope you took your ReliefFactor.com with you, Penny, and out there working for Hung Cao in Virginia and Vega and Jen Kiggins, at Congress across the United States. I don't think we can hit 247. That's the high water mark in the modern era for the Republican Party in the House. But we can get up to 230. And I really do think maybe 235. My over-under is 25 pickups for the Republicans. So we will see. My over-under in the Senate was 1. I raised it to 2 for the Republicans. It looks to me like Democrats are throwing down their shields and their swords and running away. They are going through the 5 stages of grief right now, and Jim Garrity, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. Joe Biden may not realize fully how much of a knockdown he's going to get, but I want to play for you again. New Hampshire, Don Bulldog. All right, get out there, New Hampshire. Listen to this.
In the early days after 9/11, he went to Afghanistan to hunt terrorists. General Don Bulldog, a true American hero, one of the legendary Lions of Kandahar. Bulldog survived a 2,000-pound bomb explosion and a helicopter crash that almost killed him until someone handed him a rifle to fight his way out. 10 tours of duty, 5 Bronze Stars, 2 Purple Hearts. The first general in American history to come forward with PTS, Bulldog inspired thousands in uniform to get the critical help they need. General Don Bulldog has made the motto of our state the story of his life. Now Bulldog is on a new mission to take on the corrupt Washington career politicians in both parties and turn this great country around. General Don Bulldog, a true American hero for New Hampshire.
I'm Don Bulldog, and I approve this message.
Paid for by Don Bulldog for U.S.
Senate. I cover all of the Granite State. WGAN in Portland gets the northern part. My stations in Manchester and in Keene get the southern part. Please go out and vote New Hampshire. We need that seat, and if it comes in for Don Bulldog tonight early, Democrats might just start crying and never stop crying until, I don't know, next year. Stay tuned, America. Special guest coming up on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of The Hugh Hewitt Show brought to you by Sierra Pacific Mortgage. For more info, call 888-888-1172.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, live inside the Beltway on Election Day. Make sure you get out and vote. 50 years ago, my next guest stormed an airplane, got shot for his efforts, saved a bunch of passengers, four Palestinian terrorists killed. But you probably better know him as the once and future Prime Minister of Israel, Bibi Netanyahu. Mr. Prime Minister, welcome to the Hugh Hewitt Show. Great to have you on.
Good to be with you.
And with your audience
as well.
I have greatly enjoyed Bibi, my story. Jonathan Karp sent it to me on Friday, and I've done nothing but read it and listen to it. And I enjoyed the fact that you recorded the end of the book, but not the beginning. So I got through your accent pretty good at the end there. Let's start with the beginning, though. And an argument among brothers on a tarmac about who is going to rush into an airplane. I've never read that before. That might be familiar to listeners in Israel, but it ain't familiar to Americans. That's kind of an extraordinary story.
Well, indeed it was. I can tell you that far from being an extraordinary story, it was an extraordinary, in many ways, an unbelievable moment in my life. And it's one where my brother was pitted against me. We had 16 soldiers from our unit, dressed as mechanics, about to fix, in quotes, fix a hijacked plane. That was a ruse arranged by Defense Minister Dayan to overtake this hijacked plane that was landed near Tel Aviv. The terrorists demanded that we release 300 jailed terrorists, and if Israel didn't agree, they'd blow up the plane with all its passengers. Dayan seemed to acquiesce to their request, falsely, of course. But we had to fix the plane to allow it to fly with the released terrorists to a destination of the choice of the hijackers. We got on the plane. We were to get on the plane as mechanics, situate ourselves in front of these various entrances, and then storm on a prearranged signal, storm the plane and kill the terrorists and release the hostages. No one had ever done that before. So we were all ready to go. We had practiced, dressed up in mechanics, white mechanics overall, stuck the red of pistols in our boots. We couldn't use our Uzis and Kalashnikov assault rifles, which were our normal weapons, because they were too big to hide, and also because their firepower could have endangered the passengers. And now we're all ready to go. And my older brother, Jonathan, Yoni, who was senior to me in our unit, came to me and he said, well, I'm going too. And I said, you can't go. He said, why not? I said, well, because I'm already there. And you can't have two brothers in such close quarters because obviously one of us could, or even both of us could get killed. We were afraid the terrorists would blow up the plane with prearranged charges that they put on the aircraft. And then he said to me, well, then I'll go in your stead. And I said, you can't go in my place because these are my soldiers. And he said, so we'll both go. And I said, Yoni, what are you talking about? Think of father and mother. Think of what would happen if one of us got hurt or killed. And he said something to me that was unbelievable. He said, very slowly and very deliberately, he said, Bibi, my life is my own. And my death is my own. And I saw that iron resolution that he had. And of course, I pushed him off as far as I could, but we had to go to the commander of the unit, and he sided with me. So my brother was left behind. Well,
my favorite part, and only a brother could do this, it's an amazing story with which to begin a book, but only a brother could stand over his wounded brother as Yoni stood over you because you took the bullet and say, Bibi, I told you not to go. I laughed out loud when I read that because only a brother could do that, right?
Well, he didn't know when I was shot by friendly fire in the storming of the aircraft, and we killed two of the terrorists and captured two of the women terrorists. And liberated the plane, and tragically, one young woman, a young mother, was killed by the terrorists. But we were able to liberate everyone else. And I was the only military casualty. I got shot in the arm, And as I lay on the tarmac, I could see Yoni rushing to me, and he had a terrible look of distress on his face. And as he approached me, he could see the white splatter of blood as he stood over me on my sleeve. That's where I got shot, in my arm. And a huge grin spread over his face, and he said, "See, Bibi, I told you not to go."
Yeah. I am the youngest of three boys, Mr. Prime Minister, so I identify with Ito through this thing. But I am not a soldier, and I've never been a soldier. I think that's an amazing story. Mama told you not to go. Listen, there are many, many memorable portraits in here. Yoni is by far the most memorable. Did you you wrote this in longhand during your 1 year in opposition. Did you set out to make this a testament to Yoni? Because that's what it is.
Well, I think it's interwoven with the story of my family and my brother, obviously. And my father was a great historian of the Jewish people and also a great activist for Zionism in the 1930s and 1940s during the war, especially in America, where he met just about everyone, including General Eisenhower. My story is woven with the story of the rise of Israel and the mission that informed my family and me to assure the security, prosperity, and permanence of the one and only Jewish state. But of course, the story of my own family, of my brother and my father, my mother and my brother too, looms large in this saga. Did I set out to write? Yes, I wanted, of course, to tell people, especially people outside the country who don't know the story of my brother. And obviously, I wanted to bring that to life because 4 years later, he commanded the perhaps the most celebrated rescue mission of modern times, which is the rescue in Uganda, in Entebbe, Uganda, of another hijacked plane. See, this time the terrorists thought, well, we can't land the plane, the hijacked plane in Tel Aviv, because we proved that we would liberate it. So they decided to take it to the heart of Africa, thousands of miles away, and surely Israel couldn't do anything there. Well, they were wrong.
They were very wrong.
Dead of night, my brother landed with the unit that I had served in. I was by then already a student in Cambridge, Massachusetts at MIT, and Yoni had become the commander of this unit, leading his men storm the old terminal in the Entebbe airport where the hostages were kept, liberated 103 Jewish hostages, killed the Ugandan troops, destroyed the Ugandan MiGs that protected, could have given chase to the plane, and performed the what the Drew Middleton, who was a very respected commentator of the New York military, analyst of the New York Times, said was an operation without precedent in military history. He died there, leading his men. It was perhaps the most tragic moment of my life. Not perhaps, for sure. Second only to the task of telling my parents, as I did, about the fall of their oldest son.
Yeah, that is actually the most moving part of the book, Mr. Prime Minister, when you drive 7 hours from Boston to Ithaca and your father lets out what you say is an animal cry. I've actually seen that by another father, and your mother screams, but you had to do it. And the recounting of that, I appreciate it. It's really a fine book. I want to compliment you on weaving the history of Israel from its founding in 1948, I mean, you're born in 1949, but we get the 1956 war, we get the Six-Day War in 1967, the 1973 war when you fly back, and you find Yoni in an orchard. It's all pretty amazing, but you do effortlessly weave the story of Israel into Bibi, My Story. By the way, it's available at bbmystory.com if you want an autographed copy of Bibi, My Story. So I got to ask you, though, I began Bibi, My Story immediately after finishing Tom Cotton's book, Only the Strong. And Senator Cotton, like you, led men in combat. I'm beginning to wonder whether or not that is crucial for countries to put leaders into position who've actually had shots fired at them and who've had to kill enemies of the state. What difference does that make in leading a country to go from being the dispatch to being the dispatcher?
Well, it's a world of difference because when you're in these special units, you know, hankering to go to take on any mission. You think you're, you know, you think you're a band of supermen. And in many ways, you are, but you're not, because the difference between success and tragedy is could be a few centimeters, as it was in the case with Yoni. He was hit and died. Yet you have that that eagerness to carry out these life-saving missions, as do your men. But for me, the difference was that I had seen the loss of loved ones, not only my brother, but when I was 18, shortly after I got into the special unit, a close friend of mine actually died in my arms, died on the way to a hospital. You know, 30 years later, I came to visit his home. I never got to visit his home in the city of Beersheba in the south of Israel. And his mother opened the door for me, and she showed me his room, my friend's room. She left it exactly as it was 30 years earlier. So I always thought, when I dispatched men into combat, when I made that decision, I always thought of my mother and of his mother and the mothers of Israel. And I remembered what my brother told me when I went to officer school. He said to me, and he had been an experienced commander, he had been a veteran of many battles, an unbelievable, I would say, poet warrior, philosopher warrior. But he said to me, you know, the difference between a good commander and a bad commander is that a bad commander squanders the life of his men, and a good commander accomplishes the mission with minimal or no casualties. And I always thought of that, that the life of our soldiers is so precious. And the horror and the anguish of the bereaved families is so deep that I had to be a good commander and accomplish the mission, but do it with the best economy. That's a terrible word. The minimal loss of life that you can achieve. So I always thought that. And of course, when I didn't authorize missions that brave soldiers and brilliant soldiers worked so hard to prepare, and on occasion, not many, but on occasion, I didn't authorize it, they would be just as frustrated. And they probably thought,
you're right,
you know, who's this? What is this old fogey? I mean, how come he doesn't authorize it? So the unit that I served in was modeled on an Israeli commando unit that was operated in the 1950s. One of its commander was actually Ariel Sharon, who was a great general, later became Israel's prime minister. But it was also modeled on the British SAS, the Special Air Service, that was formed by a very eccentric and equally brilliant commander. His name was David Sterling, whom I actually met once in London. And David Sterling's motto was, "Who dares wins." And that was the motto in Hebrew that was put on the wall of the unit's dining room. So one time, when I had the many missions of the unit that I had authorized, the unit commander gave me a little souvenir from this extraordinary mission. And they said this, they wrote on this, "Who dares wins if the boss dares to authorize."
Now, throughout this, there are some harrowing moments. You almost drown in the Suez Canal. You mentioned centimeters. If someone doesn't extend a hand, you're dead because you jumped in the water with I don't know how many kilometers of, how many kilograms of weight on you, and you were sinking like a rock. Another time, you have to get a soldier off of his knees in the Golan Heights. In fact, the Golan Heights were hard on both you and your brothers, all of them. So it's a matter of inches in war. When you're making that decision to go or not go, and this is going to lead me to Iran, what is the ultimate calculation, Mr. Prime Minister?
I think the first thing is whether you can maintain a clear head in the midst of battle or in the midst of enormous duress. In the Suez firefight, we were at the time at war with Egypt. Happily, that's behind us. But we had a terrible war of attrition, and we were being attacked by the Egyptians who crossed the canal to our side. and were raiding our people, killing them wholesale. And the Army Command decided to send my unit to their side of the canal. And we successfully did that one night and ambushed an Egyptian military convoy. And, by the way, not a pleasant experience to see people in agony and die. It's something that I never rejoiced in, put it this way. But, of course, there was great rejoicing on our side. So they said, okay, we'll send you another time. And 48 hours passed between this successful raid and the next one. And as we got into these Zodiac rubber boats across the canal, as we approached close to the Egyptian side of the canal, the Egyptians had dug foxholes every 100 meters without our knowing it, and they opened just a horrific fire at us, which killed one of my friends in the boat right in front of us. And I thought that we'd be much safer. And if you want to imagine, just think of these movies that you see, like the Landing in Normandy. So just imagine this horrific fire that is being fired at you, and you're like sitting ducks, literally sitting ducks, in these rubber boats, 30, 40, 50 yards from the Egyptian position. And we began rolling our boats back. And I thought and said to my fellow soldiers on this boat, we'd be much safer in the water because the bullets, they lose their trajectory. And so we all jumped into the water except the guy who stayed to steer the boat back. I forgot that although I had a life vest, I had only half inflated it. In my hurry to jump into the water, I forgot that I was carrying a 40-pound pack, ammunition pack. I was a gunner with a machine gun. And, of course, I left the machine gun in the boat, but the back pack was on strapped very tightly, combat fashion, on my back. And as soon as I jumped into the water, I began sinking like a rock to the bowels of the Suez Canal. And I realized that I was going to drown. The boat, in the meantime, moved towards our side. And I tried desperately to reach back the surface. With my lungs were beginning to fill with water. I managed to reach the surface, drowned again, mustered all the strength that I had for one last kick for life. And, at that point, you're overcome with tremendous, just on the verge of panic and suffocation, which is, it's a question, what is the worst death? Having experienced near death by drowning, I'd say that's pretty high on the list. But somehow I managed to muster enough strength to give one last kick, reach the surface, not quite, my hand actually reached the surface, and somebody grabbed my hand and connected it to the rope on the rubber boat. They must have seen me, and they took the boat back, strapped me to the boat, pulled me into it, and that's how I survived that. So what was I thinking at the time? Life, how do I live? How do I overcome death? But that's when you were trying to save yourself. At other times, when you're a commander, as I was later, and you described on the Golan Heights, and it's actually on the Hermon Mountain, coming back from an operation in Syria, trying to save my men because we were caught in a blizzard. We were wet. We were exhausted. And we were suffering from hypothermia. And I knew that if we don't make it up that mountain, we all die. And one of the soldiers in my under my command, who happened to be the biggest guy there, to weigh 230 pounds at least, and he just sat. He just sat in the snow. And I knew at that point that he's going to die. Now I'm frozen. My hands are frozen. My fingers are swollen to the size of cucumbers. I couldn't do anything with them. And I slapped the guy on the face. And I told him, get up. And he looked at me with these glazed eyes. He couldn't do anything. He just sat there. And I know he's going to die. I had to get him off. And I just had to have a clear head. And remember, now, this is anguish because you're, it's very painful. Everything is very painful because you're freezing. Your extremities are freezing. Your feet are frozen. Your hands are frozen. And your mind is frozen. So I thought, how the hell, you know, think, what are you going to do? You're going to let this guy die here? No. So I came up with an idea. And the idea was that we had what we call survival kits. The survival kit was nothing more than caramelized milk in a aluminum tube. So I said, okay, I'll give this guy a shot of glucose, and that might get him up. I got the survival, this tube out of my pack. I unscrewed the top, you know, it's a plastic covering. And now I was going to turn it around and puncture that aluminum seal at the top of these tubes. And unfortunately, because my hands were so swollen, I lost the cover. And it just sank into, a meter of snow. So there's no way I could find it. And I said, you mean to tell me, I'm talking to myself, you're going to let this man die because you can't puncture this aluminum tube? And then I thought of a solution. I carried, as the commander, an Uzi submachine gun. The Uzi has a forward sight, which is a little triangle shaped. It's like a little pyramid, pointed pyramid, which is used for the gun sight. And I called one of the soldiers. I said, hold the weapon. And he held the weapon. And I took the tube and punctured it on this frontal sight. And sure enough, the aluminum seal was punctured. I took it, you know, if you can imagine, like Popeye the Sailor, when you give him the spinach. So I gave this soldier this caramelized milk, which luckily hadn't frozen. And sure enough, he shot up like...
Popped right up. Yeah, Mr.
Got right up.
And I got it.
We all made it back.
I want to turn to Iran. I want to turn to Iran and then come back into the book and go back and forth.
The answer to that, in combat or in moments of distress, you have to muster all your strength. And when you're a commander, all your clear-headedness above the fray to think of what is it that must be done to win the day. It's that.
What must
that,
be done?
That extends obviously to other things as well.
This is why I'm so glad you won. Now, I'm an American. I'm not an Israeli, but I follow your... Michael Oren is a weekly guest on this show. I read everything about Israeli politics. Your win is enormous. It's significant. And you have one big decision ahead of you, and I don't expect you to tell me about that. But one of the things Senator Cotton quoted in his book was Sulla the Roman, who on his tomb has, "No friend has ever done me a favor, nor enemy an injury that I have not repaid in full." Is that a good guide for the leader of a country?
Well, it's a guide. I think the most important thing is the lesson that we, the Jewish people, learn, and that is that if somebody says that they're going to annihilate you, and I would say the world and the Jewish people in particular oftentimes didn't take it seriously, and the most recently in the worst tragedy that befell any people, and that is, of course, the Holocaust. Hitler was broadcasting his plans, and people didn't take him seriously. And when he started targeting the Jews, people didn't understand that it would begin with the annihilation of the Jews, but it would continue, and almost did, with the annihilation of our civilization as we knew it. Well, we don't need that other lesson. So when Iran pledges daily to annihilate another 6 million Jews in Israel, to annihilate the Jewish state, I take them